Statistics are a beast. They make victims of those who submit to them, and they lie to those who treat them as present realities rather than past truths. But let's just take a moment. Let's take a moment to add up some statistics of a black, fatherless, homeless, dropout, felon. And what you get when you add it all up, you get misfortune. But let's take another moment to divide that by a dream, determination, drive, and some amazing opportunities. So at the end of the day, all it takes is one, just one, to create new statistics.
Tribulation, but I know God. Satan wanna put me in a bow tie.
Pray that the holy water don't go dry, yeah, yeah. As I look around me, so many motherfuckers wanna down me. But enemy gon' never drown me. In front of a dirty double mirror, they found me. And I love myself.
The world is a ghetto, big guns and dicky
side. I love myself.
But they can do what they want when they play one, I don't mind.
I love myself.
When I was younger, a typical day in the summertime would just be filled with basketball. Wake up, play basketball. It was nonstop. I mean, those are back in the days when you had a lot of energy to do those type of things and you didn't have any type of chill or any type of, oh, I'm sleepy, I need a nap. It was just energy, energy, energy. So it was just fun, fun, fun. It was an escape.
One thing I always noticed about Shaquielle was that, man, he loved the game of basketball. Like, I played it and I liked watching it. But he loved it.
The first time I saw Shaquielle play was in elementary, and I saw that he had a passion for the game even back then and a love for it. He had athletic ability as well, and so I kind of knew then that he would be a great player.
First time I remember Shaquielle playing was when he was younger, over to his aunt's house in South Bend. My cousin Lisa, she had a basketball hoop in the driveway, and he was in there shooting around with his brothers and his cousins and everything. And then after that, as he got older, he had moved away, and I didn't really see a lot of that. But when he first came to Kentucky, he was in a 5-on-5 tournament, and that's when I seen him as an older child, you know, as a teen, and I was kind of floored. I was blown away with the fact of how high he could jump and the way he shot. His athleticism was totally off the charts.
Well, my mom got remarried when I was in middle school, so I would say that was probably one of the tougher transitions throughout my life. I can just remember driving away from South Bend with tears in my eyes, leaving my brother, my sister behind. I had my little brother and my mom, but South Bend, Indiana was all I knew. So going out to Seattle, I was kind of scared. I was kind of timid. I didn't know anybody. I didn't know what to expect. Once I finally got out to high school out there, it was very interesting. My freshman year, I went to Cleveland High School, extremely gang affiliated, a lot of African Americans, and I could say from there, the only way I was respected was by basketball. When I stepped on the court for the first time at Cleveland High School, I knew that I would once want to go to the NBA, but it wasn't the same amount of hunger. It was kind of more fear. I didn't know what to expect. You know, the unknown is fearful, so I would look around and I would see these kids, they're just like me. And you know, they have the same type of edge that I have. So it was kind of just like, it was just a learning process. And that's how it's been my whole career, is learn, instead of just, you know, doing it blindly. I would see something and try to imitate it. Even though I went to a predominantly less wealthier school, at that point in time, in my mom's marriage, we were we were wealthy. We weren't poor, we weren't middle class. We were wealthy, we had money. So everything that I asked for then, I got. So it was kind of like me being babied. But at the same time, that's kind of what I moved into with moving into Seattle. And we stayed in a nice house. I got the finest of everything. And it, you know, we were living extremely well. Upon moving out to Kent, Washington, is when things, I would say, started to get a little bit shaky as far as financially. So it kind of flip-flopped. When I was at Cleveland, we had money, but when I got to Kentridge, it was kind of like the lack thereof. And, you know, I just kind of always wanted things that, going to a predominantly white school, you see them have a lot of things that you don't have. And it's a lot of envy and jealousy. I chose to ignore it initially. I was just getting by, you know, basketball is my outlet.
Feeling my way through the darkness, guided by a beating heart. I can't tell where the journey will end, but I know where to start. So wake me up when it's all over, when I'm wiser and I'm older. All this time I was finding myself and I didn't know I was lost.
At first I just thought he was kind of just doing what everybody else does. Everybody kind of has that time in their lives where they just kind of need to get it out. And so I thought that was kind of the start of it, but it went a little longer and it got a little more serious, I think, than I expected. And so it was scary. It was a real scary time. I think he was, I don't know, I guess I thought at a time he was at the point of no return. So it was hard.
But I woke up. Two of my best friends called me. We met up and we went around knocking on houses to see if anybody was there. And we went to this one particular house I'll never forget. We knocked on the door maybe 100 times and then finally we broke the window. And once we broke the window, somebody came to the door and couldn't really speak that much English. But we knew what he was getting, the gist of what he was saying. Basically, he called the police and they're on their way. So immediately we take off, not even entering any house at all. And we were on the run for about, you know, an hour and a half. And this neighborhood was next to my neighborhood, so I pretty much knew the ins and outs of it. That's why we were able to last as long as we did. Going through backyards, down alleys, through trees and walkways. And once I finally make it back to my house, we come in really extremely loud and, you know, we're like, oh, we got a sigh of relief. And then I realized my stepdad is home. He had a broken foot. So he's upstairs, he comes downstairs and he asks me what happened. And I'm just like, nothing. And next thing you know, the police are swarming everywhere. And once we hear that, we just dart out the side door for another 45 minutes on the run. And we hear dogs, we hear helicopters, we hear sirens, we hear police speeding by, and we're just going house to house, just trying not to get caught. And then I never forget, my friend looked over at me and was like, you know, it's no way of getting out of this. So we kind of just always took a bow out. So we went to a backyard, kind of just chilled there until they got there. The police came, threw us on the ground. You know, I had the shotguns aimed at our back, and at that point, hello jail. So I'm riding around in the back seat of the cop car, and the cop is like, just tell them everything they want to hear and you'll go home. And I was kind of looking at him in a suspicious way, like, I don't know if that'd be the best idea. I mean, technically all we did was break a window. And it turns out they drive us around the neighborhood to the house that we were at, to the couple, and it turns out that they were deaf. So basically they couldn't hear us knocking. They couldn't hear the window breaking. They just felt the vibrations from the window. But we get to the precinct, and basically it's two ladies, two investigators, and they're sitting there questioning me, saying this and saying that. And I'm just like, yo, I don't care about anything you're saying. I did it. You know, my friends had nothing to do with it. You know, they did absolutely nothing. And they're like, oh, why are you trying to take the rap for it? And I sat there and looked in her face and I said, because I'm the one that can recover the best from it.
When I first heard that Shaquielle was in jail and was in this trouble, I was so disappointed, but yet I was so concerned because I knew that he had so much potential. Academically, he was smart. He had athletic abilities and he could go far. But when I heard that, that's my son, and I was there for him, but I don't.
After being caught robbing houses or whatnot, I spent about 3 months in jail. And I mean, it wasn't the prettiest scene, but I mean, after looking back on it in hindsight, I feel like that really shaped me into the man I am today, because you learn discipline, you learn how to have a hunger, you develop a hunger that I never had before going into jail. And I'm not glorifying, you know, my time in jail, but I could say that, you know, that definitely helped shape me into the man I am today. Along with the 2 years of probation, that was tough, having to take a drug test every other week, sometimes 2 weeks in a row. Probation officer coming to your house, being able pretty much to do whatever they want. You were basically state property. During that 2 year span, I basically stayed at 10 different places. With the domestic issue occurring in my mother's marriage with my stepfather, it initially allowed her to lose the house. Reasons being, a restraining order was immediately issued. And basically, with my stepdad being the primary breadwinner, and he brought in the money, my mom didn't have enough money to pay for the house any longer. So she had to go stay at a women's shelter with my little brother.
Effect on me, not too much. Shaquille, it affected him a lot, I'm sure. We had to relocate to Indiana. He stayed there, went through a lot of troubling times. So I'd say it had a pretty big effect on our family as a whole.
It kind of just sent me for a whirlwind. Once she told me they were moving back to Indianapolis, Indiana, you know, that hurt. I was already dealing with a lot of things, and to know that I wouldn't have family there, you know, on top of that, to turn to and be able to go to anytime I need anything. But at the same time, I knew I couldn't leave Seattle, Washington for basketball purposes. I was pretty much well known out there from high school, so I felt like I had to stay there to create this path to be able to go Division I and play basketball. So wake me up. October 31st, 2010. I went out that night to celebrate Halloween, just like millions of kids across America did. During the course of the night, my best friend LaRon Daniel gets a phone call, and LaRon's generally a happy dude. Like, there's really no type of sadness ever about him. And then when I looked over at him, you know, his whole expression changed. And initially, I thought I didn't really know what to think. And I looked at him, and he immediately storms out of the room in tears. And I'm just like, I gotta go check on my friend. And right the moment I step out of the house, he said, it's Devin. And I'm just like, okay, what with Devin? And he was like, they say Devin died. Initially, we didn't really have concrete proof that happened. And then another good friend, Anissa Cerner, called, and she confirmed, and she was just like, yeah, he's laying right here. So I guess that night, they say he got into an argument with the guy. Nobody really knows what happened. And I guess they got into a fight. And then amongst the ending of the fight, I guess the guy pulled out a gun and started shooting. And they said Devin was pierced in his back, and he basically bled to death. And before I say anything else, I just want to... I just feel so bad for his family, his little sister, everybody that knew him, because I honestly felt like the world just lost a good person that day. I don't feel like it's fair to me to have so much success because something as ugly as that has driven me to this point. You know, with everything that I do, it's for number 40. It's, you know, it's for my brothers. But I can say honestly that I do feel like he's happy. He's happy to see me doing what I'm doing. Just like I'm happy every time a game comes on, I hear his name on ESPN, ABC, Fox Sports. I don't care about the story. Like, I did a lot of wrong things happened to me, but this is exactly how I pictured it, sitting in my jail cell. I wouldn't change a thing that has happened to this day. I would not change one thing. I do not care. People can say what they want about me. They can call me a felon, a high school dropout, college dropout. I don't care, because I'm doing what I want to do in my life. And you know, I owe a lot of that to Devin's death. And I know he's proud of me. And that's why I don't seek the approval for anybody else with anything that I do. People can judge, people can say this, people can say that, but I made it to where I want to be in life. You know, I'm in school, I'm getting a degree. Yeah, I made a lot of bad decisions, but so does everybody else. I don't feel like people should judge other people just because I sin in a different way than you do. So, I mean, I'm happy where I'm at. And if I could say one thing to Devin right now, it'd just be thank you, and I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm gonna miss that kid. I'm gonna miss him to death.
Running till the fear is gone. Don't know where I'm going. Don't know if I make it home. Tell mama I'm sorry. I know that I've made mistakes. Tell her it ain't easy. I see a wrong judgment day.
With my felony, along with the domestic violence, and Devin dying, I felt like I've seen it all at this point. And I was ready to make a change for the better in my life. And I decided at that point, nothing's gonna stop me. So during the 2-year probation span, there was a lot of things that had happened to where I could have quit, I could have gave up. But if it wasn't me thinking about me having a felony or the domestic violence, it was definitely me wanting to carry on Devin's legacy. So I originally completed my first year at Edmonds Community College by dropping out. I sat out 2 years after that. The second year was more so an initial red shirt year, as far as I got to get these classes taken care of. You know, I got to do this, I got to do this, I got to get my life back in order as far as with everything that's cycloning around it. That second year off, I really thought I was going to get back into classes, and I had everything set up for me to succeed, and at the last minute it just didn't fall through. So I was kind of hurt after that. I was discouraged, but I knew that I would be playing basketball as a career no matter what. The spring of the third year, I re-enrolled into Edmonds Community College to pursue my associate's degree and also try to come back and play another year at JUCO. Once I got past those first batch of classes, well, I believe I finished with a 3.7 that quarter. I was like, okay, I'm right there. I took 15 credits then. Then I took another 15 credits. Then I took another 15 credits. Then I took another 15 credits. And then I basically had 7 weeks to complete 25 credits. And in my mind, I wasn't gonna fail the finish line was right there as far as, you know, being able to play Division I basketball. After getting MVP honors of my league and losing in the championship, it was kind of minuscule to the season that I just came off of, which was one of the most statistically prolific seasons that the NWAC has seen in a very long time, to anybody's knowledge. A man by the name of Kevin Williamson contacted me from a Division II school, Minnesota Duluth, and he basically was recruiting me pretty hard because I had 2 years Division II. And once I told him, no, I'm going Division I or, you know, I'm not doing anything else, I'm going Division I, and he said, okay. So he got into contact with the man known today as Stan Johnson, the man who made it all happen. he see my highlight tape, he called me on the phone, and he told me straight up, I would never lie to you. You know, I would never tell you something that you want to hear, and I would be brutally honest with you from here until. And that's exactly how our relationship has been since that day. He made sure I stayed on top of my classes. He was talking to people at Arizona State, basically going out on a limb to get me there. And with the pass that I had, I really didn't know if he'll be able to do it. And once he told me about 2 to 3 weeks later that they're gonna fly me out on a visit, I said, okay, you know, this could actually happen. I went down there to the campus, 117 degrees. I loved every minute of it. It was one of the biggest campuses in the world, population-wise, and it was just so different. It was like something I'd never seen, going from being in a jail cell to years later being on the campus of a Pac-12 school. You know, it really struck me mentally. And I honestly want to thank Coach Stan Johnson for giving me that opportunity and believing when other people didn't. You know, a lot of people wrote me off, and he went out on a limb, and I feel like it paid dividends for everybody. Everybody got to feel the advantages of it. This past year at Arizona State, I can literally say, you know, I had the time of my life. You know, it was everything that I dreamed about, from, you know, from Cleveland High School to Kentridge High School to Edmonds to here. It was always what I thought it was gonna be. And it's amazing, it truly is. You know, I got to play my season out. You know, I had a relatively good season. And once it came to an end, I didn't know where I was gonna be this year. I had the option of overseas or petitioning for a second year to come back and play for Arizona State. And with my pass, you know, it was a long shot, I would say. A guy by the name of Steve Webb at Arizona State really put his everything into making sure that I would have the best case being brought forth to the compliance office here in Indianapolis. And once we submitted it, you know, it took a week. It took one more week. I remember not being able to eat, you know, sick to my stomach. You know, Steve was like, you know, it's gonna be okay. You know, whatever happened is gonna happen. Coach Stan was feeling the same way, along with Coach Herb. And the day that I got the news that I would get my second year, it was like music to my ears. I woke up, I turned over my phone, and there it was on the ESPN app on the front of my phone saying, you know, Shaquielle McKissic has been granted his second year of D1 eligibility. And I just smiled from ear to ear. I was a little baby at that point. I called my mom, I called Coach Herb, and you know, from that day forth, it's been on. My hopes for this upcoming year is definitely to make another NCAA run. We lose guys like Jermaine Marshall, Jahi Carson, Jordan Baczynski, all to, you know, their professional careers. But I definitely want to make it back. After feeling that, how live it was on TV and just the atmosphere, it's a beast. And, you know, it's something I definitely want to be a part of in my final year. And to lose the way we did, you know, it's kind of that bitter taste in my mouth. I haven't went back to look at that play since. But, you know, it plays over my head, you know, however many times a day, and that's kind of what fuels me. So at this point, you know, it's all business. You know, I'm ready to get back to work. You know, I'm ready to make all of this happen once again.
I made it through the... Tell them that I'm... that I need more, more, more. Tell them that we need more, more, more. Right now, right now, right now. I know it's been a long, long, it's been a long, long time. Long time, I know it's been a long, long time. But it's never, never been too late. It's never, never been too late. It's never,